brought to you by Kenneth Nugent. From the station that's on your side, News 12, First at 5, continues.
First at 5, state leaders are checking on a local apartment complex under investigation for its poor living conditions. For years, we've reported about troubles at the Bon Air, and today's visit will be the first status update since its last failed inspection.
We're also tracking a rain threat that could dampen our weekend plans, and you know we don't like that.
No. It's been a little more than a month now since Congressman Rick Allen was sent a letter stating the Bon Air apartments in Augusta were being investigated for poor living conditions after failing its latest inspection. That comes after Allen called for the Federal Housing Authority to launch a formal investigation into living conditions at the complex in April. He cited our 2016 I-Team investigation that found people were living months without heat in the winter and air in the summer, plus mold and poorly managed units.
The people living there also told News 12 about their concerns over safety, crime, drugs, and other conditions.
And today's visit will be the first status update since that last failed inspection. Our Claire Allen just finished speaking to Congressman Allen not too long ago. Claire, what can you tell us from his tour today?
Yeah, Meredith. Congressman Rick Allen did an hour-long tour of Bon Air Apartments. He is calling for total renovation for this property. And part of that tour, Congressman Allen says, he was shown a new security system the owners put in place. Allen says he wants to make sure the people who live here are secure and crime activity goes down. We told you last month Bon Air Apartments failed HUD's inspection in June. In a letter to the Georgia congressman, it says that 17 points were deducted for problems with the building's exterior. Allen says this building hasn't been renovated since the 1980s. He met with the new owners asking them, what are their plans and how on schedule are they to get this building up to par?
So what they've committed to us is that they're going to do a better job of communication so that you can get that information out. And we're going to give you some of the materials they gave us today. They have made some commitments. They are waiting on some tax credits and things like that that you typically get with historic properties. And we're going to assist them with that.
Now, some of the people I spoke with off camera tell me that some of the problems they are having include having no air for months and more crime. On News 12 at 6 o'clock, I will have Congressman Rick Allen's response to those complaints. Reporting live from Bon Air Apartments, Claire Allen on your side.
Historic property that has seen better days, and we want the best for those folks over there. Claire, thank you. The Richmond County Sheriff's Office says these two men are wanted in connection with a kidnapping on Amanda Circle yesterday, less than a mile away from McDuffie Woods Community Center. Deputies say they are Tavares Johnson and Taquez Bright. If you've seen them or know anything about where they might be, call the Sheriff's Office at the number that we can pass along to you on our website.
More news in just a moment, but first,
heading our way over the next few days in just about 10 minutes.
All right, thanks for that, Riley. The Columbia County Sheriff's Office needs your help searching for a runaway teenager. Take a good look. Investigators tell us 17-year-old Dylan Biggers was last seen yesterday around 5:30 on Washington Road in Evans. He was driving a silver 2007 Toyota Corolla with a Georgia tag. Dylan is 5'7", 125 pounds, and has brown hair and brown eyes. If you've seen him, if you know where he is, please call the Columbia County Sheriff's Office.
Richmond County deputies need your help finding a man who's been missing for more than a week now. They say Eddie Ruffin was last seen on Mike Patchett Highway, right around the area of Castle Pines Mobile Home Park. They say he may be suffering from dementia and has trouble walking without the walker, which he left at the house. Ruffin's known to be in the area of Food Lion on the Mike Patchett Highway. If you've seen him, contact investigators.
In North Georgia, newly uncovered genetic evidence has helped police figure out who is responsible for a crime that happened back in 1988.
As Crystal Bowie shows us, authorities believe this is the first time DNA technology identified both the victim and the killer in a single cold case.
Stacy Chahorsky was just 19 years old when she was killed. Her body found along the highway in Dade County, not far from the Alabama-Georgia border. But for the last 33 years, investigators didn't know much more, including the identities of her and her killer. decades later, finally, some answers in the form of new genealogy DNA testing. The technology is used to positively identify a person's DNA.
We're standing before you today, almost 34 years later, to say we have finally identified Stacy Chaworski's killer.
That killer, now identified as Hank Wise. Investigators say they matched a living family member's DNA to his. Wise was a trucker whose route crossed through the southeast and whose DNA was also found at the scene. Wise had a criminal history in Florida, Georgia, and North Carolina. The GBI and the FBI glad they persisted.
Stacy's mother last week to let her know that we found who the killer was, and she, of course, got upset. But she was very thankful to everybody that I mentioned, and was just overwhelmed.
Wise is no longer alive. Authorities say he died in a fiery vehicle accident in 1999. But now the family has some peace. Their daughter's killer is no longer roaming free.
And let this serve as a warning to every murderer, rapist, and violent offender out there. The FBI and our partners will not give up. It may take years or even decades, but we are determined and we will continually seek justice for victims and their families.
Incredible. The GBI and FBI hope this technology can be used to solve future cases.
Meanwhile, executions for four death row inmates are on hold in South Carolina after a ruling from a judge. The four inmates, including Richard Moore and Brad Sigmund, were convicted of crimes in the upstate, but they sued over the state's current death row methods, arguing the state's options of the electric chair or the firing squad are unconstitutional.
The owner of Regal Cinemas is filing for bankruptcy. Cineworld made the announcement just this morning. We do have a Regal movie theater at the Augusta Exchange near Target. That British company owns more than 9,000 theaters globally. We've reached out to our local theater to see if or even how this could affect them.
Even if you don't ride the bus, Augusta Transit is also asking for more of your feedback to give riders a better experience. You can still submit a survey online or mail it to their office off Regency Boulevard. You can offer that feedback right until November. AU looking to hire more workers. There's a job fair tomorrow. They have openings in maintenance, research, public safety, nursing, and more. That's from 2 to 4 in the afternoon at the Goodwill Job Connection on Washington Road. We have the link to apply and more information on our website.
Well, it has been a hot and humid afternoon. Most of us are feeling like the mid to upper 90s across the area. Rain is moving in, though. Have an update on radar and the forecast just after the break.
Plus, there's a new golf course in Aiken County, but there's something really special about the Chalk Mine 9. We'll take you there next.
Time and still to come here, First to Five. Like everything else, the cost of home internet service is really going up. How would you like a discount on your internet bill? After the break, a new federal program that you might qualify for.
The Live IQ.
People, one eye wants to divide us. I want to bring us together. I'm Herschel Walker. I approve this message.
When the COVID-19 pandemic sent millions of Americans home to work, it became even more apparent that access to high-speed internet is no longer a luxury. It is really a necessity.
It really is in every household, but millions of Americans can't afford the high-speed internet. Our consumer tech reporter, Jamie Tucker, explains you might qualify for a discount on the internet and a computer.
At this point, new iPhones get only incrementally better than the previous iPhones. Maybe a better camera, faster chip, higher price tag. But if you're happy with the iPhone you have now, save your money and do this instead. Give your phone a quick refresh by addressing a data hog that takes up space and slows everything down. Go to General Settings, iPhone Storage, which shows you files and content that's taking up space. A good bit of that space is labeled as Other. It's simply data and documents, leftovers from apps, messages, photos, and social media posts. Facebook is a good example. On my phone, the app itself is just over 200 megabytes, but it's storing another 240 that I don't need. That's Other. Get rid of it by deleting the app and reinstalling it. You're not going to lose anything, and you'll get back that storage space. Another option is to reset your phone back to factory settings. Back up the phone to the computer or iCloud. Do not skip that step. Then back in settings, reset the phone and choose erase all content and settings. Scary, I know, but if you backed up the phone, you're going to be fine. The phone will be like it was when you got it, brand new. When prompted, restore the phone from where you backed it up. This is going to fix any of the sluggishness in about 30 minutes. Also, delete apps you don't use. especially the free ones. If you think you need a new phone because your battery is dying a lot faster, Apple now lets you replace that battery. You can do that at a Best Buy store or Apple store for a lot less than it costs to buy a new phone, or you can get a portable battery charger. Get the most life out of your smartphone and save a lot of money. That's What the Tech. I'm Jamie Tucker.
I'm always going back to watch Jamie's stories on the website, which you can do, by the way, because it's like a seminar every time
he's
talking about
it is.
Technology.
He teaches. It's really news you can use.
It really is. So the Affordable Connectivity Program was created through the $1.2 trillion infrastructure bill signed by the president back in November.
Well, I hope everyone enjoyed the dry weather the past few days, because our pattern's going to turn a little bit on the wet side heading into the weekend. Cooler temps, though, high staying in the mid to low 80s Saturday and Sunday. Now look at the 7-day forecast just out of print. Make sure those gutters and storm drains are cleared out.
Riley, thanks. That's a wrap for News 12, first at 5. Stay with us after the break. Laura Warren joins me for News 12 at 6 o'clock, and we'll see you then.
Closed captioning for News 12 is brought to you by Kenneth Nugent. From the station that's on your side, this is News 12 at 6 o'clock.
If you have plans tonight or over the next couple of days, make sure to factor in the rain. Parts of our area could get up to 3 inches by the time the weekend is over.
Plus, after years of violations and Bon Air Apartments' most recent failed inspection, Congressman Rick Allen went to see the issues today for himself. What he found coming up. But first, we're learning more about a deputy standoff turned murder investigation in McDuffie County. The GBI says it involves a couple where the husband shot and killed his wife.
Our Will Rio has been following up with the sheriff's office and the GBI all afternoon to find out more. He's live in the newsroom now with the latest.
Well, the GBI has identified the suspect in the shooting as 74-year-old James Wilson III. The McDuffie County coroner has identified the victim as 75-year-old Virginia Sue Wilson. Now, the GBI says they found James Wilson's wife inside a rear bedroom of the home. She was shot just before the 911 call was received by the McDuffie County Sheriff's Office. Now, this was the scene on the 1400 block of Augusta Highway. When we arrived earlier this afternoon, deputies say they received the 911 call just before 10 this morning. This was what the McDuffie County Sheriff Logan Marshall saw when he arrived to the scene. Take a listen.
As soon as I pulled in the driveway, a white male was sitting on the ground with a handgun pointed to his chest. He advised me he had messed up and his wife was in the house.
Now, the sheriff says there was a short standoff, but negotiators were able to peacefully take the suspect into custody. They tell us the couple were married, but they're not sure if this was a domestic situation at this time. The sheriff has had not been called to this house before for any situation in the past. Now, we spoke with neighbors who say the house is about 3/4 of a mile down the driveway, so we weren't able to see what the house looked like. It's all family-owned property as well. The McDuffie County Sheriff says the investigation has been turned over to the GBI. James Wilson is being charged with murder and possession of a firearm during a crime. We'll keep you updated as this investigation continues.
All right, a sad story all the way around, Will. Thanks.
The weather now is going to give you a live look outside.
You should cool off relatively quickly. Our temps are going to stay near 90 over the next hour or so, and then fall to near 70 by early tomorrow morning. We are expecting much greater rain chances over the next several days, potentially a flood risk. We'll have an update there in just about 10 minutes.
All right, thanks for that, Riley. Our I-team has investigated safety issues and violations at the Bon Air Apartments for years. From last June to December, we found more than 150 police reports within 1 mile of the apartments. Just a few months ago, Congressman Rick Allen called on HUD to investigate the unlivable conditions at the complex. And today, he came to Augusta to see the issues firsthand. Our Claire Allen is live there now as we speak after hearing from Allen about today's visit. So, Claire, what was his reactions when he saw it firsthand?
Yeah, Laura, Congressman Rick Allen is calling for a total renovation for Bon Air Apartments. He toured and met with the new owners, and they met with HUD also to see how they can fix this place up. Wednesday's visit is the first status update since Bon Air Apartments failed their last inspection. The new owner showed Congressman Allen a new security system aimed to tackle the issue of crime.
Where they're monitoring every exit and just about every corridor in the building so that they can immediately see if someone's in this building that shouldn't be here. And we want to make sure, like I said, that our residents are secure.
Tenants have called Congressman Allen with complaints about mold and mildew, no air for months, and safety issues at the place they call home.
They are either working now or in the process of making them work. I think it's a bit of a communication problem here. We have made them aware of that, and again, that's something they've got to address and fix.
Allen is also calling for transparency between the owners and tenants to move forward.
But the management company really needs to sit down with the residents, show them what they're going to do, and take care of their needs. And I think they understand that after our meeting today.
The congressman says he and others will continue to monitor this property very closely.
Obviously, time will tell.
Allen also adds that he's looking forward to working with the new mayor and the commission on numerous housing issues right here in Augusta. Reporting live from Bon Air Apartments, Claire Allen, on your side.
Okay, thanks, Claire. The legality of abortion in South Carolina is under debate right now at the State House. The version up for debate in the Senate right now almost totally bans the procedure in the state. The state Senate began its debate this morning considering a bill that would only allow abortion under two circumstances: when the mother's life or health is in jeopardy, and in cases of lethal fetal anomalies, when the baby could not survive on its own outside the womb. As the bill is now, it would not allow abortions for victims of rape or for incest. Democrats have refused to vote on any amendments, saying it's not their job to make better what they believe is a bad bill. So that's left the disagreements today to Republicans, who hold a dominant majority in the Senate.
That is what the killing of innocent people is. It's an attack on the image of God in creation. Why I feel so compelled to speak.
If you want to believe that God is wanting you to push a bill through with no exception that kills mothers and ruins the lives of children, lets mothers bring home babies to bury them, then I think you're miscommunicating with God. Or maybe you're just not communicating with him at all.
Very strong words on all sides of such a charged issue. Again, the Senate is still in the midst of that debate right now at the State House, and the State House of Representatives passed an abortion bill last week, which does allow for exceptions for rape and incest. But if the Senate votes on this new version of the bill, it would return back to House members for their consideration.
New this evening, the Columbia County Sheriff's Office says they need help finding a missing teenager. 17-year-old Dylan Briggers, last seen at the Lowe's on Washington Road in Evans. Deputies say he was driving a silver Toyota Corolla. They say it has Georgia plates, TCI 5649, and there's also a sticker on the back window. It says In Focus. If you've seen him or have any information about where he might be, call the Columbia County Sheriff's Office. In Richmond County, the Sheriff's Office still trying to find a missing man, Eddie Ruffin, missing since the end of last month. The Sheriff's Office says the 72-year-old suffers from dementia, could be without his walker right now. They say he was last seen near the Castle Pines Mobile Home Park off Mike Padgett Highway. Deputies say he's known to use the food line about 5 minutes down the street from the mobile home park. The Salvation Army Center of Hope in Augusta says they could use some help themselves.
Because of rising food insecurity and poverty, they say the number of people they help has gone up 120%. Hallie Turner shows us how you can help.
In the past few months, they have nearly doubled their number of guests who stay here. The result of serving now 400 meals a day are causing them to use more supplies than they can get in. As you can see, this is what they currently have left in their meat freezer. Major Raymer says due to costs, it's only going to get worse.
So we've seen a significant increase in those that we're serving at our Center of Hope. We've actually almost doubled in how many are staying at our Center of Hope.
And that's just since June. Chef Lannis Fryer says the unexpected spike is increasing their food expenses and depleting their pantry.
Well, the biggest price increase is probably going to be on the meats, because everything is up from ground beef to poultry, pork.
Right now, the Center of Hope is on track to serve more than 140,000 meals over the course of the next year, which adds a lot of stress.
Now you've got to come up with a plan to kind of figure out to make things stretch so that you can feed all the people.
The shelter is starting to experience crowding in the rooms and are close to capacity.
Well, we haven't hit that number yet, but we are approaching that number.
They have anywhere from 140 to 150 people currently.
The goal is within the first 24 to 48 hours when you've come in the first time is to meet with a caseworker so that those things can happen so that we can help get you on your feet.
Many are not leaving and their fear is what's to come in their peak season. Major Raymer says they are in desperate need of food donations such as meats, proteins, canned food, any non-perishables, or even fresh produce. If you'd like to make a donation, you can drop them off at the Croc Center, at any of their family stores, or right here at the Center of Hope. Reporting to you in Augusta, Hallie Turner, On Your Side.
So we could all donate, but if you also want to volunteer some time to help those... head to the Salvation Army Southern Region website, and you can scroll over ways to give. Click Volunteer to sign up. If you or the family need some help with food, Golden Harvest has a giveaway tomorrow at their Food Faith Factory on Commerce Drive from 5:30 until 7:30. Anyone's welcome. It's a drive-through style, so you stay in your car and volunteers place the food in your trunk. Be sure to clean that out for them, and they do have fresh produce to give away.
South Carolina native Asia Wilson has only been in the WNBA for 5 years, and she's already won her second MVP. Dan has the latest on the former Gamecock next in sports.
And we have been mostly dry this afternoon, but heavy rain and thunderstorms starting to move in from the north. Update on the forecast just after break. On the degrees for Sunday afternoon, but staying pretty wet. Make sure you have those indoor plans for the weekend.
On Your Sideline, sports brought to you by the Hawk Law Group.
Good evening, everyone. Let's start in the WNBA, where former University of South Carolina standout Asia Wilson has become the seventh player in league history to win MVP for the second time in her career. Wilson's second MVP campaign was bolstered by the fact that she finished second in rebounding, fifth in points, shot over 50% from the field, and won Defensive Player of the Year. By taking down the Seattle Storm last night, Wilson and the Las Vegas Aces punched their ticket to the WNBA Finals. In addition to all of her recent success, you might remember in 2017, Wilson led the University of South Carolina to their first national title in program history. Now to college football. Clemson is coming off of Monday's 41-10 win over Georgia Tech, and despite that impressive victory inside Mercedes-Benz Stadium, the Tigers dropped back a spot from number 4 to number 5 in the AP poll. Clemson got off to somewhat of a slow start against the Yellow Jackets, but when they got rolling, they looked like a team that deserved to be ranked in the top 5. Here's a fun stat for you. With this win over Georgia Tech, Clemson has now won 60 consecutive games going into halftime with a lead.
We're 119-2 when we have a lead going into the fourth quarter. And to me, that's a reflection of everything that your program is about. We've had a lot of close games that we've had to win. And so that, to me, is a credit to our strength and conditioning, our coaching staff, the mentality of our kids.
The Tigers went into the half up 14-3 and outscored the Yellow Jackets 27-7 in the second half. This Saturday, Clemson will host the Furman Paladins in Death Valley for their home opener.
The Burke County Sheriff says their old jail is at capacity, putting staff and inmates' lives in harm's way. Coming up, he highlights the battles they're facing inside the barbed wire.
The live by strong arm.
The Burke County Sheriff's Office is pointing out several major issues they say need to be addressed now. In a letter Sheriff Alfonso Williams sent to commissioners, he says the jail is so full they're having to move inmates to other counties.
Sheriff Williams says at his jail there's not enough room to lock down inmates who could be a threat to themselves, to officers, or to other inmates. Sheriff Williams says putting inmates in other jails is costing the county thousands of dollars a week. Right now, the sheriff says they're having to release low-level offenders back onto the streets because they don't have the space to safely hold them. Other low-level offenders are being housed with violent offenders. The sheriff says he's making a plea to the county commission to send whatever money they can before the situation gets even worse.
If we don't get in on the SPLOST funding for November with the right amount of money to fix this issue, we won't get to revisit this again until 2030. And we cannot go the next 8 years with the current detention facility at max capacity. And that's where we are.
Sheriff Williams says they could need millions more in additional funding. And tonight at 11, we're going to break down more of those issues the Burke County Sheriff highlights with the jail's infrastructure. And we'll hear possible solutions to keep staff and inmates safe until they can work out the funding.
Tonight, we're on your side to break down how to get this year's tax rebate in South Carolina. The Department of Revenue is issuing more than $1 billion in tax rebates that you should get if you're a taxpayer by the end of this year. So first off, you need to have filed your taxes for last year by October 17th of this year. So if you keep filing extensions, time to go ahead and get those in because it means cash money. If you owe anything on your taxes, that will get subtracted from the rebate that they'll send you. You also need to live in South Carolina at least part-time or be a non-resident. If you're non-resident, you do not get this break. Some other important info, married couples filing jointly get one rebate. You could still get a rebate even if you did not get a tax refund this year. If you moved to South Carolina this year and you did not work in the state last year, you're probably not going to be eligible. Service members stationed outside of the state is part of their duty, but live in South Carolina could be eligible. And if you filed a South Carolina return last year, we'll have the link to see all of this information for you posted on our website.
Georgia health officials say updated COVID boosters will be in the state by the end of this week. The updated shots protect against the BA4 and BA5 COVID variants. You're eligible if it's been at least 2 months since your last COVID shot. Earlier this week, South Carolina's health officials announcing 50,000 doses of this new booster coming to the state. You'll be able to schedule your new shots at the CVS or a Walgreens. Augusta University Police completing their active shooter training presentation today. The AU campus community invited to come out and hear about those strategies to protect life in these dangerous kinds of situations. And they broke down common myths people might assume about shooters or situations. Their main point to people listening, it can happen anywhere at any time, but reporting suspicious situations can help save lives.
If we can have people reporting that ahead of time, we might be able to intervene in order to prevent the violence.
AU police say having a plan is the best way to protect students, and their plan is focused on protecting life and eliminating the threat.
Well, we are expecting a wet weekend ahead. Make sure you have some indoor plans ready for each afternoon. And look at the 7-day for you just after the break. Coming up, we'll have the chance for some scattered showers and thunderstorms Thursday afternoon. On Friday, really can't rule out a shower or thunderstorm at any point during the day Friday. And for the weekend, unfortunately, not looking great for any outdoor plans.
I know what Dan's thinking already. Maybe another wet Friday night.
Probably, but hey, we will be doing the necessary things to make sure it all goes well.
There might be some dry weather mixed in, so not necessarily an all washout day Friday. So keep your fingers crossed.
Thinking Athens Saturday.
Not looking great.
All right, that's going to do it for us. Our next live update is 7 o'clock over on NBC.
A washout and a blowout Saturday.